Okay, so the last time we talked about the differences between user space thread implementation and the kernel space thread implementation. We said that there is no thing as one is better than the other. It depends on the situation. We like this picture because it is more efficient. Context switching is much more efficient than the kernel level threads. But the problem with this one is the main problems are these. Okay, the blocking system calls our problem. Why? Because if one of the threads are blocked, then the operating system kernel doesn't know that I am running more than one thread in my process. So the whole process and all the threads are blocked, which is bad because I am trying to do some parallel programming. Also, similarly, page faults. We don't know what page faults are, but they are basically virtual memory related stuff. With the virtual memory, if I need to load some pages from the disk to the memory, if one of the threads needs a new page, then all the others are blocked because the kernel thinks that for that process to continue, I need those pages, but in fact, some of them, they don't need it. And maybe this one is as important as this one, okay? If I have more than one processor on my computer, processor assignment is done by the scheduler, okay? By the kernel. If the kernel doesn't know that I have more than one thread in my process, then that's going to be a problem. Okay, so these are the three things, and I think we talked about them last time. The block, okay, we said that. And the page fault, we talked about it. And the opposite of this picture is then, let's use kernel space to implement everything. And in this case, we say that the kernel manages all the thread-related processes to create or destroy or other kind of manipulations with the threading is done by the kernel. So what you do is you make system calls, lots of system calls. It will make your operating system more complicated, kernel more complicated. And similar to our process table, we have a thread table. Often the thread table and the process table are integrated, but still I need to keep all that information in my kernel space. Blocking system calls are gone. Of course, I mean, if one of the threads are blocked, that thread is blocked. I cannot do anything about it, but other threads in the same process can continue now. So no problem with block system calls. And if I have more than one CPU available, I can assign as a kernel, I can assign one thread, one CPU to one thread. And this way my multi-programming, parallel programming would be much more efficient in terms of CPU usage. Okay, but the downside is, I need to make lots of operating system calls. Making an operating system call is expensive because it needs switching, context switching from the user mode to the kernel mode. It is not as expensive as switching from one process to another process, but still it is more expensive than user level threads. Okay, so these are the two opposing ends of implementation of threads in the user space or the kernel level space. Okay, so there are other problems with the multi-threading. Actually, think about fork. When you make a system call fork, okay, fork means that I will make a new process exactly the same as the parent. Okay. Does that mean that if the parent process has five threads, am I getting 5 more threads in my new process? So you need to make a decision on that, okay, right? You need to make a decision on that because fork is called, fork is asked by one of the threads, okay? If that thread wants a fork for itself, then how am I going to make this decision? It's a problem. I mean, by problem, it's a designer's problem. How would you design your multi-threading library to handle forks, okay? And how about signals? If I hit Control C, which thread would receive the signal? Okay, that's another small issue that you need to handle. What I'm saying is that threads. Remember how we came up with the idea of thread? We said that processes are actually we can discriminate between the resource grouping and execution of the processes into two parts. The idea was simple, but processes are complex things. If you make these kind of simplifications, then you will run into these kind of problems. So how are you going to handle the fork? How are you going to handle the signal and other kinds of stuff? How about the files and etc.? So we are not going to go into details of these because the solution depends on what you want. What kind of results you want from your threading. In practice, or Linux or Windows or other types of operating system, these kind of things has to be handled. Okay. So, what did I say? There are two opposing ends of the thread implementation, and there are some solutions in between. There is a hybrid implementation, and there is the scheduler activations. Let's look at this hybrid implementation. So, hybrid implementation says that I like the efficiency of user level threads, but I like the non-blocking nature of the kernel level threads. So why don't I use something in between, like this? Okay, the kernel thinks that there are two threads. Kernel level threads are running inside this process P1. This is my process, P1. This is what kernel thinks. But inside that process, my user-level process handling library, okay, multiplexes 3 threads into 1. And here I multiplex 2 threads into 1. So for the kernel, as long as the kernel is concerned, okay, there are 2 threads happening inside that process, but in fact there are 5 threads are happening. 5 executions are happening at the same time. Okay, so how is this a hybrid approach? It is hybrid because switching from this thread to this thread is so fast. From this thread to this thread is so fast, but switching from this thread to this thread requires kernel level processing. Okay, it is more expensive. If this one asks some data from the disk, okay, if this one says that I need some data from the disk, all 3 of them will be blocked. Why? Because the kernel thinks that this thread is asking a system call. Okay, so all 3 of them are blocked, but still these 2 can continue. Okay, so it's a solution in between. It takes advantage of user level threads in terms of efficiency, and it takes advantage of kernel level threads in terms of non-blocking system calls and taking advantage of more than one CPU. Okay, good. Any questions? Okay, yes.
Is it the most frequently used one?
You mean this one? Actually, in pthread library, I don't remember seeing this. I don't remember the interface to this kind of usage of threads. In thread library, I don't remember this. So I don't know. Okay. So it's just a solution. Just a solution. Okay. I don't remember how you specify I want kernel level threads or user level. They are both available in Linux, Unix, Windows 2. But I don't remember. Anybody knows how to specify kernel level or user level threads in Linux? Those people who took the systems programming course?
I think there is kthread and pthread.
What?
Kthread and pthread.
Kthread and pthread?
Yes.
Yeah, so you, if you like to create a kernel thread, you call kthread create and yes, the other one is user? Okay. But that doesn't offer you any hybrid approach, right? I want two user level threads inside this kthread. I don't know, it's all implementation dependent, but pthreads are kind of standard. I don't know. Okay. So this is one. Remember what we said? There are advantages and disadvantages to both user level and kernel level ones. And this is a hybrid approach. Another approach says that, okay, I like the user level thread so much. Okay. I like the user level thread so much because they are very efficient. But I don't want to be get blocked. I don't want that. So they came up with this idea. There is a concept called upcalls. Some people don't like it, but it is available. Okay. It says that I will get the best of both worlds, efficiency of user level threads and non-blocking ability of kernel level threads. So this is how it works. This is how it works. Normally the user programs call functions in the kernel. Okay. When you make a system call, if it blocks, if it doesn't block, then everything is fine because I am not blocked. There is no problem with the user level threads. But if I am the user level thread, okay, I am making a system call, and if that call is blocked, then the operating system makes an up call to my user level kernel thread processing library. It is like this. I will draw a simple picture. Okay. And this is my application. This is my kernel. And this is my user level thread library. Okay. And this is my T1 and this is my T2. Thread 1 and thread 2. Thread 1 and thread 2. Okay. Maybe I should do this. This would be better. This is my process, P1, and this is my kernel. If T1 asks something from the kernel, like read disk, okay, if the data is ready, there is no blocking. But if the data is not ready, the whole process will be blocked, right? This kind of systems, they say that, okay, I will not block you, but immediately say that to the user level thread library. This thread T1 asked me to do something, but the data is not ready. So I am letting you know. So this user level thread routine says that, okay, I will block T1. Now T2 can start working. Okay. So the kernel never blocks. It doesn't say I am blocked. The data is not ready. Kernel doesn't say that I'm blocking. It says that to the user level thread library that one of your threads asked me to do something, but the data is not available. So I am letting you know. So this user level thread says that, okay, I will keep using the CPU, but this time I will let T2 run. Okay. This is the first step. The second step is whenever that data is ready, the kernel again informs the user level thread library about the situation. And in that case, that library can reschedule T1 so that it can start running. So what did we do? We prevented blocking system calls. Okay, no system call will be blocked. Of course, T1 will be blocked, but the whole process, we are talking about the whole process, processor can continue with the execution of other threads. So we solved this problem. Okay. So this is called scheduler activations. We are activating the We are activating the scheduler of the multi-threading library. Okay. I don't know what's going on. Usually when I do this, I just rebooted the whole computer. Okay. Let me start this again. This one, right? So scheduler activation means that I am activating the scheduler as a kernel so that the scheduler can schedule something else. Okay, that's called scheduler activation. And this is done using the upcalls. As I said before, some people don't like upcalls. They say that it works this way. This is my layered approach. This is my application. This is my library. This is my OS or kernel. Okay. The application asks something from the library. Library asks something from the kernel. Kernel says that, okay, your data is ready, etc. It goes that way. When in the case of upcalls, the kernel says that this data is ready. This is not happening. So the kernel starts something. Kernel starts something and says that such and such happened. This and this happened. Okay? That's what happens with the upcalls. That's why some people don't like it. They say that it violates the usual layering approach. Okay? It's an unclean interface. But that's what we have been doing with the signals of Unix, right? Signals are like that. When I hit Control Z or Control C, I send a signal to my application from the kernel side. Okay? So the information doesn't come from the request doesn't come from the application side, but from the user side. Okay, anyway, so this approach solves this blocking system calls. But it didn't solve the other problem. What is the other problem? What? We had two bad problems for the user level thread implementation. One was the blocking system calls, the other one was multi-CPU. So this doesn't help with the multi-CPU, right? Because I have the kernel thinks that I have a single thread happening, but if I have more than one, I mean, upcalls or scheduler activation doesn't help in that case. Okay, but still, it's a solution that uses user level threads, which is efficient. But also, this solution lets you get away from this blocking system calls problem. I think I had a question. Somebody was. You, anybody has a question? No. Okay. So the schedule activations, thread creation scheduling is done at the user level. It is so efficient. Okay. When a system call from the thread blocks, the kernel does not does an up call to the thread manager. That's called scheduler activation. Okay. So it doesn't block the whole process. It says say that this thread, whoever is asking me, I can't do that. Okay. The thread manager, of course, is more complicated now. Thread manager says that this one is blocked, so I will let the others run. And when a kernel interrupt occurs, that's relevant to the thread, another up call is done to unblock it. So one up call is here, the other up call is there. Okay, good. I will not talk about this pop-up threads. It is related, but I don't have time for this, so I will skip. So far we talked about types of threads, user-level threads, kernel-level threads, yes. But we did not talk about the details or the problems of writing multi-threaded applications, which is important because, I mean, if you don't know how to write multi-threaded applications, if you don't know the problems of multi-threaded applications, then having multi-threaded libraries or kernel is not an advantage for you. So in what ways should you be careful about writing programs for the multi-threading? So the thing is that the first thing is local variables are parameters. they are no problem because local, your local variables and your parameters, function parameters, are kept in your local stack, right? Each thread has its own stack. So whatever you are modifying in your stack is your business. Nobody else cares about it. Nobody else has access to it. So it's no problem. The problem is with the global variables. Okay, it's the global variables. Global variables are since they are accessible to all the threads, we need to be careful about them. Okay, we need to be careful about them. The book says that the variables that are global to the thread but not global to the entire program are a problem. What does, well, like, this is not a, I mean, this is not a very correct sentence. There are some problems with it, but let's say this sentence means what it means. It says that if the variables are global to the whole thread but not the entire program, it's a problem. Why? Because, I mean, in a thread, what do I have? I have a number of functions, right? I call one function after another function. And if I like to have this function share some data, okay, share some data as globals, but I don't want those globals to be seen by the other threads, then that's going to be a problem. Okay, if the globals are shared by all the threads of a single process, then that's not a problem. That's what book says. Well, we are going to see that that's a problem too. But let's pretend it's not a problem. If that's the case. Then we need to be careful. What I mean here is this. Let's say I have a process here, and this is my one of my threads, second thread and third thread. I know that each one has their own stacks, stack and stack. So T1, T2, T3, they all have their own stack. Local variables and parameters are no problem. But let's say this T1 uses the function names F1, F2, and F3. This one uses F4, F5, and F6. Again, this is F7 and F9. Let's say these three needs to share some data, a global value, let's say G1. G1 will be used by this one. G2 will be used by this one, and G3 will be used by these two. Okay, so that's the problem the book says. I mean, if there is a global named G, and if all of them are sharing this G, there is no problem because since all the globals are shared by all the threads, each thread can access this one, read it, write it, no problem. But if I like these three functions to use only G1 and no access to G2 and G3, that would be a problem. That's what the book says. Okay. Well, the one solution would be, let's not use any globals. That's what we say to you, right? When we write the object-oriented programs, we say that don't write any globals. Don't use any globals. That would solve the problem. But it is not that easy. Sometimes I need to use globals. Sometimes I need to convert some old programs to multi-threaded programs. Okay. So another solution is this. Okay. For each thread, let's allocate a chunk of memory for the globals, and let's pass the address of this chunk of memory to each function within that thread. Okay, so maybe I have a library that creates a global memory, but that's global only for that thread. It's global. Okay. And I could set it, I could read it, and I can live my life like this. Okay, so it is pretending like, even though maybe I should be clear here. When I say each thread has their own stack, yes, that's true. But still, since they are in the same address space, this thread, if it wants, can access to this stack, and this thread, if it likes, can write and read from the stack of the other thread. Usually I don't want I don't want to do this kind of stuff because I am cooperating with within these three threads, but it is possible. So what I am pretending is that as thread one, number one, I pretend that I don't have an access to this stack and this stack. And I'm going to do the same thing again. If these are my stacks, okay, if these are my stacks, let's say this is thread number one, thread number two, and thread number three. And if these are my stacks, stack number one, stack number two, and stack number three, I will add more memory like globals one, okay, and globals two, and globals three. Okay, so my library, my threading library is going to do this. Okay, so how do I handle this? How do I create these kind of pieces? I make these kind of function calls. And I think there was a, okay, yeah, picture from the book. Okay, this is within my address space of my process, let's say process number one. Inside process number one, I have the code for thread number one, and I have to code for thread number two, and I have some memory chunk for the thread one stack, and I have some memory chunk for thread two stack, and I have some memory chunk of memory for the globals of thread one and thread two. Okay, so this way, maybe I could handle globals that are common to a thread. As we said before, if the globals are shared by all the threads, then I don't have any problems. Okay, good. So this is one of the concerns about writing multi-threaded applications. Okay. Well, at the beginning we said that we like sharing the address space with the other threads. That's what we said at the beginning. But it turns out that sharing address space with the other threads sometimes creates problems, and we need to deal with these kind of problems. And this is one of the problems. Okay. Okay. So let's look at the second problem. The second problem is this. I drew a very nice picture here. Okay. In this nice picture, I try to hide something, some detail, very bad detail maybe. I thought that was my plan. Each thread has their own set of functions, right? Each thread, it has their own set of functions, which doesn't have to be the case for the real life. Maybe there is a function, let's say F10, it is all shared by all the threads. All of them are making a function call for F10, okay? Would this normally create a problem? If let's say T1 and T2 are calling the same function F10 at the same time, and we have multiple CPUs, would this create a problem?
Depends on F10.
In terms of local variables, there is no problem, right? Because each thread, this F10 uses this stack, this F10 uses this stack, and this F10 uses this stack. So in terms of parameters that I pass, or in terms of local variables, there is no problem. So that solution is a very nice solution, but the problem happens here. If within my program F10, if I use static variables, right? Remember what static variables are from your C? If you have static local variables, static local variables are actually global variables, right? I mean, when the function ends, they keep their value. So if I call, just tell me a C function that uses static variables inside it. What? Can you hear him? What did he say? Okay, we only three of us know what is. Token is a string tokenization, strtok. Remember strtok, that tokenizes a string. It uses some static variables in it, okay? It has some memory. You make a call first. It remembers how you initiate it. After the first call, each time you make a new call, it gives you another token from your string, right? So if three of them are calling the same function, that's going to be a problem. So that's why they tell you, that never use static variables inside your functions, okay? Because that's not multi-threadable, okay? That function cannot be used in a multi-threaded application. So I need to be careful. What did we say? What are we discussing right now? We are discussing how to write, okay, multi-threaded code. How to make a single-threaded code into a multi-threaded application, okay? If you are going to do that, don't use any static variables. Don't use any static variables. So how am I going to handle it? How am I going to handle all this kind of stuff? So let's look at the more details, okay? We said that if each thread is calling the same function, that's okay if that function is using all the local variables and the parameters, then no problem. But the function should be careful about multi-threading, okay? Static variables is a bad thing. And we say that static variables are not the only bad thing, actually. There are other bad things in there, too. If I obey all the rules of multi-threading, I would call my function, my new function, a re-entrant function. Re-entrant. Re-entrant means that the same function could be used by many threads at the same time. Okay? strtalk is not a re-entrant function. Okay, strtalk is not a re-entrant function. And in C libraries that were developed in the 1970s, there are many functions that uses static variables. And we don't like those kind of stuff. Okay, so the re-entrant routine or re-entrant function is a routine, okay, that can be invoked more than once simultaneously. Okay, at the same time, the same code is running inside more than one thread. At the same time, since each one is using their local variables, there should not be any problem if the function is re-entrant. Okay? Can only use local variables or dynamically allocated variables. Okay? Only local variables or the dynamically allocated variables. Must not use static variables. Okay? But unfortunately, many C library routines do use static buffers. This function, local time does this. It takes an integer, okay, and it converts that integer to a time variable. Like when you say local time 0, it returns a struct, and inside that struct it says that January 1st 00000 1974. So the local time returns you the exact date and time given the number of seconds elapsed since 1974. Okay, that's what it does. But how does it return a struct? Okay, all I'm giving is just an integer. I give it an integer and it returns me a very large struct. Okay, how does it do it? If you give a function something, it should return you something else, but it says that I am returning a struct, okay, struct pointer. So it needs to create the struct somewhere in the memory. Maybe it creates it in the heap. No, it doesn't do it. The local time solves this problem by using static variables inside it. Okay. So this is our standard local time of C. This is not re-entered because it uses static variables. So how do we fix this problem? We fix this problem like this. We say that, okay, I'm going to give you the number of seconds elapsed since 1974. Also, I'm going to give you an address of the struct TM, and you will write your results inside the struct. So as a caller of that function, I provide space to write the results. Okay? So I supply a buffer. So this function is re-entrant. This is not. Okay? So if you are writing multi-threaded functions, then you should be careful about these. How about if you are writing an application, if you are writing an application that uses more than one process? Do we have the same problem there? Do we have the same problem? I am writing an application that uses more than one process in it, and each process is using this normal version of local time. Is that a problem?
No.
No, why not?
All of them has their own stacks.
Well, in this case, my threads, their own stacks.
They have their own address spaces, which separates the variables.
Exactly. Since each process has its own address space, their locals as well as their globals are all separated. They are all different. So static variables are kept inside my global space, my heap, which is shared by all the threads. But in my processes, I don't have any shared data between the processes. So these kind of stuff is expected for the multi-process application. So in 1970s, when they first developed this C library routines, of course they had the multi-process applications, right? They had the function call system called fork, right? But in that case, it wasn't a problem. This kind of functions became problem when they started using multi-threading in 1980s. Okay, good. Any questions? Where is the attendance sheet? Attendance sheet. Okay, good. Okay, it's time to. If there are no questions, then I will. Any questions? Esra Sert. Esra, very okay. Esra, what is your question? What is your question? You have a question now. Tell me another function which is not reentrant from C. Okay, I'm going to ask you a question then. Tell me a function that is not reentrant. A function that you know. Just write another function then, okay? Write a function that you would say that this would not be reentrant. I mean, don't write a function that uses a static variable. We already know that. Tell me a function. Anybody else? Yes.
Printf, isn't it?
Why do you say that printf is not? Printf has a buffer to modify. And that's a buffer, a global buffer. Yeah. So that's a good example, but we want that kind of bad reentrant behavior because we want all of our threads to use the same buffer so that we could see whatever they are printing, right? I mean, the solution, what would be the solution? The solution would be each one has separate buffer and each one would have their own terminals, right? That would be the solution, but usually we don't want that. But that's a good. So the other case would be instead of using static variables, if the functions are using some kind of a global variable, then that would be a problem too. But you know, as you know, statics are globals anyway. Yes.
What if they using the kernel buffer, for example, peer?
Yeah.
Not the user buffer, but kernel level.
That's the same thing again. I mean, I wouldn't call that function a reentrant function because it is using some kind of a global. If the function uses anything other than the local data, local variables, variables from the static, then I wouldn't call that a reentrant function because if two threads are using the same function at the same time, they would start modifying the same global variable or static variable at the same time. So writing reentrant functions is something needed if you are writing multi-threaded applications. I am not talking about, of course, these are parallel programs, but I am not talking about parallel programs in general. I am talking about parallel programs that are multi-threaded. Okay, so multi-threading and reentrant functions are very much related to each other. Okay, so what if I need global variables then? Maybe you could say that, okay, if you need the global variables, if you need the, for example, printf, it needs the global buffer so that it tries to it. Okay, it tries to it. So you are free to use that global buffer in the case of printf. Okay. But sometimes, I mean, the situations are not as good as the printf's case. Sometimes this happens. Let's look at this picture. Okay. Remember the spoolers? The second generation computers, the spoolers. I have a process, a print process, running on my computer, okay, in my system. It says that, okay, I have a, maybe I should draw it like here, okay. I have three processes, P1, P2, and my printer spooler. Printer spooler, okay. Printer spooler keeps, printer spooler, let's say, it keeps a array like this, array of strings, okay, array of strings. Its job is to check this array, and out for means that I have a pointer at the beginning of the array, and in means that I have a pointer to the end of the array. If out is smaller than in, then this print spooler takes this file and sends it to the printer and increments out by one. So out will be 5 and I will print here. And it continues like that, okay? Until there are no files left to be printed. That's what the print spooler does. P1 and P2 are regular processes. They like to do their own stuff, and from time to time, they like to print files out. So how do they do that? They say that, okay, let me write the code for the, let's say this is, but PD is the name of the array. Let's say PD in is, let's say, P1 file, okay? And then after doing that, what should I do? What? No, this is the name of the file. I just say that I like to print this file, maybe I should do this. Okay, .txt. I like to print this P1 file to the printer. Okay, so I put my file in this position, position number 7. So it is p1 file.txt. Then after that, what should I do?
Increment.
Yeah, maybe in should be in plus 1 so that it is not 7 anymore, it is 8. Okay, so next one will be here. Okay, so let's say in P2, I am doing the same thing, okay? If you like to print something out, you should do using the shared buffer in, let's say, it is p2.txt. And then again, in gets the value of in plus 1. Good. So without sharing some data, this wouldn't be possible, right? This wouldn't be possible to communicate between P1 and print spooler, P2 and print spooler, right? That wouldn't be possible. This is called inter-process communication. Inter-process communication. Well, we said that processes, they don't share their address spaces. How come I can access the same PD from this one and from this one and from that one? Well, operating systems has some mechanism. They said, okay, I like to share this chunk of memory. I like to share that piece of memory between these processes. Okay, that's what you could say. Okay, so I am behaving like PD in and out are global variables, and that's what I am doing. Okay, so what if in this case I need globals and I'm using the globals? But the problem here is this. Let's say the CPU decided that P1 should run. Okay, P1 is running. P1 executed this line. Okay, P1 executed this line, and my program counter is here. Okay, an interrupt occurred, a timer interrupt occurred, and scheduler is running now. And scheduler decided that maybe P2 should run. Okay, so I did this. I write P1 file txt in my seventh position. Okay, in my seventh position. But since I switch my process now, this one is running. This one says that PDN should get the value of p2.txt. What is the value of in? It's the same. So it's going to write, how am I gonna, my pen doesn't. Okay. It's going to write P2 blue p2.txt, and it will increment in by one, so in will be 8. So what happened? We lost the file, right? P1 thinks that it printed P1 file.txt to the printer, but at the end spooler cannot find it, because when this spooler comes to seventh position of this global buffer, it will see that there is a p2.txt. So at the end, my user of P1 will not see his or her file printed in on the printer. So the problem here is that, what did we say? If you like to share the globals, yeah, you could share it. No problem. But if you start sharing your globals like this, there will be problems. So you should be careful. How would you solve this problem? What?
By blocking the resource.
By then, blocking the resource?
Then P1
will... Just explain what you mean by blocking the resource. We block processes, we don't block resources. I mean, at least we don't know.
Some kind of mechanisms like mutex or semaphore.
Nobody knows about mutexes. Yes?
Context switch, we should keep the backup from, we should backup the resources and also the open files. So when the context switch happens again, it can continue.
So what are you gonna backup? You are gonna backup the whole file,
yes.
whole buffer.
Open files.
No. If you backup your, you mean, if you backup this directory, this array, then How is the printer spooler will know about the newly added data? Your suggestion is, let's backup this one, let's make a copy of it, right? When we come back, the thing is that this one writes, and this one reads. You cannot take a copy of it, and you cannot restore it.
But we want to prevent p1.txt
to
disappear, so we have to backup the status of it.
Yeah.
Cursor.
So every time when I do a context switch, you are saying that, okay, P1 did this and P2 did this. When I switch back to P1, it will erase everything that P2 did, right?
Yes.
Then I am going to use P2's data. The thing is that this line will be read by this printer spooler. Okay, printer spooler will read either this one or that one. If you do that, okay, one of them will be read by the printer spooler, the other one will not be read. You don't want to say, I am making a copy of this buffer, I am going to put it back. No.
Another suggestion, put the while and until it reads the file, if it's not returned the zero.
You are saying that let's block this.
Yes, it keeps looping until it reaches the file.
You mean this one, P1 should have a loop and P2 should have a loop too?
Yes.
Both of them. And it says that, okay, you are saying that you make a system call to the operating system, and you don't trust your operating system. You wait until your file is printed, but that's going to be very inefficient, right? I mean, every time. Do you know how many times a second you make an operating system call? Thousands of times. And every time you don't trust your operating system. I did this, but maybe he's not going to do it. Yes, I'm suspicious. That's not a good solution, no. That maybe that would work, but that's as good as running everything in sequence. Say that don't do anything else before doing whatever I ask you. Okay? You are suspending your whole computer, maybe. No, find something else. Yes? We are talking about this specific example, and you are not allowed to use whatever you have learned last year from. If you took, did you take this course before? Okay. So yeah, just give me a solution.
So we can either use a locking mechanism for the interface.
What is a locking mechanism?
Like the ones we use with the files.
With the files, I don't know what you mean.
We lock the files before we are going to write them. Then we unlock them.
When did you do that?
So
you took. Oh, okay. You are talking about last week. Something like a locking mechanism. So okay. So how do you lock this? So where did you lock? Where you put your locking mechanism in this picture?
So before I do anything about printing anything on the array,
yeah,
we just lock it so any other process can.
Okay, yeah, maybe that's a good idea. You are saying that this piece of code is important. This piece of code is important. Before I start executing this piece of code, I lock my array, okay? Nobody can have access to my array and my out and in variables. Only I can do it. So that means that since I locked it, even if there is a process switch from P1 to P2, P2 is not allowed to change anything because it is locked by this one. So this will be blocked, P2, because it is the resource it is trying to reach is locked. So P2 will run again, and the whole process will continue. So the idea is locking something, saying that I am the only owner of this piece of data at this time. So who's going to enforce these locking mechanism? Of course, the operating system. So you get help from the operating system. So back to the beginning again. We were saying that if you like to access your global data, yeah, you could do it. There is no problem with the threads. But you should be very careful about them, because if you run into these kind of problems, those kind of problems will be very difficult to detect. Because what did I say? I said, this line is executed, then there is a switch design executed, and this line executed, right? So switch has to happen at a very, very, very precise point of time. And in that case, your result is different. These kind of things are called race conditions. Race condition means that where two or more processes are reading or writing some shared data, and the final results depends on who runs precisely when, are called race conditions. We don't like race conditions. Okay, race condition says that your result depends on who runs first. Okay, I don't have control of who runs first. It is decided by the operating system, and it is influenced by many, many, many things. So whatever we're gonna do, so let's write code that doesn't involve any race conditions. We don't like race conditions. Let's prevent race conditions. Okay. So if I like to go back, okay, if you need to use global variables, okay. Yeah, you could use the global variables, but you should be careful. You should use synchronized access, okay? Locking mechanisms, and we are going to spend lots of time doing this. The whole thing is called inter-process communication, IPC. Okay? Any questions?
About the upload system.
Yes.
So we set a thread work.
So you're not talking about inter-process communication, no. Up calls, yeah.
We set a thread works, then for some reason it blocks. Kernel says, hey, your thread is blocked, so
yeah.
Make your other thread work. But kernel doesn't know about the thread's block, right?
Well, kernel kernel, yes, I mean, yeah, you could say that kernel doesn't know about the threads. All the kernel says that I got a system call from this process, and that system call is a block system call, and I am letting you know. As a process, I am letting you know, okay? So it is up to the process to make a decision after that. The process might say that, okay, I'm going to be blocked, I will wait. Or the process might say that, okay, I have some other things, I will continue using the CPU.
So if for some reason all threads in the process gets blocked,
then the,
still can say you can run to that process.
Well, it is, I mean, who kernel talks to the scheduler, right? Kernel is talking to the byte bit the up call. Kernel is talking to the scheduler of the user level thread library. That's the decision of the user level thread library. If all the threads are blocked, so what is the right decision? The kernel level thread library says that, okay, I will block myself. I will block the whole process. So it's a, I mean, that's a good point. The kernel still doesn't know or doesn't need to know about the what kind of threads I have in my process, okay? But still, it lets the process know that this system is called is going to block you, okay? If you don't want to get blocked, do something else. But any other questions? Okay, let's take 10 minutes of break. After the break, we will continue with the inter-process communication.
Race condition'a ilgili bir şey anlamadım ben tam olarak.
Ne anlamadın?
Şimdi bu local, local'lar şey kitlediğimiz zaman keşif proses.
Oradaki memory geçebileceği
yerleri
Gel, senin kadınım yapacağım.
Niye?
Ooo, MacBook'a ne ara geçtik reis?
Kardeşim ya, benim programım.
Tamam, ben yani kadının olacağım, az geçtik.
Ve MacBook her şeyi değiştirir.
Haydi. Haydi nikâh.
Eskiden tabii ucuz. Ben kendi bilgisayarımı alırken aynı fiyattalardı. Ah, bizim iki mermeti kapatmışlar.
Ben de yapmışlar. Gel, ben de. Yok. Şuraya ben. Şuraya ben. 90 tane fotoğraf.
bir şey sordum mu? Ben şey aslında neydi? Şey ha tamam şey.
Thank you. Ben de hafif olmasın.
Okay, so this is the problem. If you need to use global variables, yeah, you could use it. You could use them, but you need to be careful about about the consequences, because if you do it in an arbitrary way, you will end up losing data. You will end up having race conditions. Okay, so that's called again inter-process communication. Being careful about how you access your global data or shared data, inter-process communication. There are three things. The first one is how one process can pass information to another. But with the threads, we don't have this problem, because if you are sharing the same address space, that means sending the data to another thread is no problem. Just write it to a global variable. That's it. Okay. For the processes, it might be a little bit different. Okay, let's talk about the simple case. Let's talk about the processes first. Okay, the second has to do with making sure two or more processes do not get in each other's way. Okay, for example, this should not happen. Remember, okay, process A is trying to update this one, and process B is trying to update the same place. One is overriding overriding on the information the first one has already modified. Okay. This is the second thing. The third thing is sequencing. Okay. If I am a process, if I am modifying something, I should not depend on somebody else's decisions. Okay. So sequencing should be a problem. Whatever sequence happens, the end result should be exactly the same. Okay. So the second one and third one, we are going to look at it more carefully. And those are actually causing the race conditions. Race condition is this, okay? Race condition is the final result of your parallel program depends on the sequence of your programs running, okay? It depends on who runs first, who runs second, and who runs when. If my program depends on this information, the sequencing information, then that's a bad thing, and we call that bad thing as race conditions. And we should eliminate all kinds of race conditions in our multi-threaded, multi-programming applications. Okay, so doesn't matter when the switch occurs between this process and this process, the final result should be exactly the same. What is the final result? What is the desired final result out of these two processes? I want two files to be printed, okay? Doesn't matter this one runs first or this one runs second. Doesn't matter if there is a switch while I am doing this, if there is a switch or no switch. At the end of the day, I want two files to be printed. I don't care which one is printed first, okay? This could be printed first or this printed first, I don't know. But at the end, I want my two files printed. Otherwise, there is a race condition. Okay. So how do we prevent these kind of things from happening? We are gonna use this idea of mutual exclusion. Okay. What we need is mutual exclusion. And mutual exclusion is something achievable most of the time with the help of the operating system. It is basically a way of making sure that If one process is using a shared variable or file, the other processes will be excluded from doing the same thing. Okay? When you say, I am using this global variable or global resource, if I am using it, nobody is allowed to use it at the same time. My access is mutually exclusive access. Okay? I am not going to share this one with anybody else for a given period of time. So, if I am writing this code, if I say that when I am running these two lines of code, nobody is going to access in and PD variables. PD is an array, in is a global variable, okay? If I am executing these two lines of code, nobody is going to access them, okay? And again, P2 will say the same thing. If I am executing these two lines of code, nobody is going to access them. So these places will be called mutually exclusive. Okay? Mutually exclusive pieces of code. Can I write it here? No. Okay. Mutually exclusive pieces of code. And I will get some help from the operating system, but before that, let's try to write mutually exclusive piece of code ourselves without getting any help from the operating system using some locking mechanisms. Okay. Okay. This mutual exclusion. There's a definition of mutual exclusion. Some way of making sure that if one process is using a shared variable or file, the other process will be excluded, and the part of program where the shared memory is accessed is called the critical region or critical section. Okay, this mutually exclusive piece of code is critical region. Okay, this place is critical, this place is critical. While I'm in the critical region, nobody is allowed to use those two variables. That's what we are gonna do, critical regions. We are defining these critical regions for mutual exclusion. And for mutual, why are we dealing with the mutual exclusion? We are going to use mutual exclusion idea to prevent any race conditions. Okay? We don't like race conditions. That's a bad thing. Okay? We don't like race conditions. That's a bad thing. We know that. I said that many, many times. Detecting race conditions is a very difficult problem too, because it doesn't happen all the time. I mean, if you do this, integer pointer A and this 1, 2, 3. If you run this code, okay, maybe 50% of the time you will get a crash, right? You did not allocate any place. A points to a garbage position. Maybe probably A points to a null. A contains a null pointer, right? So this will produce a crash most of the time, maybe depending on the compiler, maybe 100% of the time. Race conditions doesn't happen that way. Okay, remember the race condition here. If I run these two lines of code, and after that I run these two lines of code, no problem. If I run these two, then after that these two, no problem. Okay. Again, most of the time I will not have any problems with these two processes because race conditions did not happen. But there is a possible race condition here, and it doesn't happen all the time. It happens maybe one out of 1,000 times, or sometimes one out of 1,000,000 times. Okay. So it is so difficult to detect these kind of race conditions, and we need to be careful about them. And once they happen, the consequences are bad. Why? Because I have a large file. Let's say I have a file of 100 pages. I thought that I printed it to the printer. I sent it to the printer. Because of the race condition, the printer did not print it, but I didn't know that. I erased my file. So what happened? My whole file is lost. And I did not get a print out of it. So that's a bad thing. So mutual exclusion to prevent race conditions is important. And writing these kind of programs is something that we need to be careful of. Okay, so let's talk about the properties of these critical regions. If I am inside the critical region, there are four rules. Okay. If I am inside the critical region, no other process can be inside that critical region. I will be the only one in that region. Okay. No two processes may be simultaneously inside the critical region. Okay. That's one thing. The second thing is, no assumptions may be made about the speeds of the number of CPUs or the number of CPUs. You cannot say that process one is so small, it will be so fast. This race condition will not happen. The probability of having this race condition is so small because I know that this will not happen. Or you might say that I have a single CPU. What are the chances of having a switch between this process to this process at this point? Okay, I mean, if you have two CPUs, maybe you could say that they are running at the same time. You cannot make these kind of assumptions. Okay, so one process could be faster than the other, slower than the other, or one of them could be, both of them could be very equally complicated functions or processes. Doesn't matter. You should not make any assumptions about how many times your critical region runs or how fast your CPU is, okay? The third one is this. If nobody is inside the critical region, okay, nobody should stop you getting into the critical region. I am not using critical region. Nobody else using critical region. So nobody should stop me to enter from entering that critical region. That's the third rule. You say that, okay, this is something stupid. Why should this happen? I will show you a critical region algorithm that will behave like it runs, it is okay. But when you realize that this rule number three is being violated, you will see that, yeah, it can happen. I mean, nobody is in the critical region, but still your processes are being blocked. Okay. And the fourth one is, you cannot say that I am into my critical region. I am inside the critical region, but I will stay here forever. No, you cannot say that. Okay. So these are the four critical region conditions. Okay. Four critical region conditions. If you satisfy all of them, then you may prevent these race conditions. If you violate only one of them, the race conditions might still happen. Okay, so let's see how we can do the critical regions first. Okay, so this is what's going to happen. A enters the critical region, process A, and there is a switch happened. Or let's say I have two CPUs. CPU 1 is running process A, and CPU 2 is running process B. A enters the critical region, it is doing something. At this time, T2, B decided to enter the critical region. But the operating system says that you are not allowed to enter the critical region. You will wait until when? Until when A leaves the critical region. After that, B enters the critical region and it leaves. So what happened inside this critical region? A put its file name and incremented the global number in that critical region. And in this critical region, B did the same thing. So there is no interference between the writings and the readings of the process A and process B, okay? Because operating system protects that critical region from each other. Good? Okay. So let's look at some of the ways of writing critical regions or some of the ways of achieving mutual exclusion. We will keep using this busy waiting. Busy waiting is something that you are suggesting, but it is a little bit different. We will see. You are suggesting that I would write my data to the appropriate place and I would keep checking it until it is cleared out. If it is not there, then you will say that, what happened to my file? I will print my file again. Right? It is similar to that one, but what you are saying is too difficult to write. And every time I make a system call, it is difficult. So busy waiting is something like that. At the end, we will not use busy waiting at all, okay, other than some simple cases. Still, I like to know what busy waiting is. Busy waiting is continue testing a variable until something happened. Okay, so let's keep this in mind. But these are the things that we are going to use to achieve mutual exclusion. Okay? Maybe the names doesn't make any sense, but we will see. The first one might make sense. Okay, let's do this. Disabling interrupts. Okay? Disabling interrupts. If two processes are trying to enter the critical region. Okay, are trying to enter the critical region. For example, process number one says that I am entering the critical region. I will update this file array, and I will increment the counter n. Okay, so before it enters the critical region, it says that I will disable all the interrupts. Once you disable all the interrupts, what happens? You know that there will be no context switches. Why? Because I disabled all the interrupts, there will be no timer interrupts, there will be no keyboard interrupts and everything, right? So is that a good idea, disabling interrupts? Why not?
Because other processes
may starve. Well, I mean, I am writing it very carefully. I mean, all I'm doing is this. This is very simple, okay? All I am doing is this. I will disable my interrupts. I will update this, and I will update this, and I will enable the interrupts. It will not take more than a few microseconds.
Another process that has high priority may come in.
Well, it will take only 2 microseconds. And I'm done in the 2 microseconds.
It's a good thing, I think.
What?
I think it's a good thing.
It's a good solution.
Yes. Until by.
Well, you should know by now that the first thing that I introduce is not a good thing, right? And we never tell you the good thing at the beginning. We tell you the good thing at the end. Yeah, and you should know this. So, why do you think it's a good thing?
Until my job is done, don't bother me.
Yeah, that's the, until my job is done, don't bother me, don't interrupt me. If you interrupt me, I'm doing something important. It will mess up everything. That's a good idea. It looks like a good idea. And in fact, it is used, but there is a serious problem with disabling interrupts. What are the problems? Yes?
If you are using real-time system, then it would be a good opportunity to...
Just two microseconds.
Maybe it is critical.
No. Well, I mean, I keep saying the same thing because in real life, we are using this disabling interrupt thing. I mean, the operating system does it that way. But you are going to say something, right? Yes.
Isn't it 2 microseconds are 2,000 instructions?
Yeah. Okay. 2 nanoseconds. How about that? Okay. 2 nanoseconds. Just two instructions.
But what happens when someone has to interrupt you?
It is 2 nanoseconds. Two instructions.
We said no assumptions. You can't assume that nothing will happen.
No. My assumption is, I cannot, the rule number 4 is, you cannot take forever to complete your job inside critical regions. What I'm saying is I have just 2 instructions. I will put my file name into the table, and I will increment the global variable name, then that's it. It will not take forever. Okay? I mean, you have to spend some time, right, inside the critical region. So you have to block the other processes. That's what I'm doing. Disabling interrupts, yes. Yeah, I mean, you cannot trust everybody. If somebody disables the interrupt and it does a mistake, right, and it crashes, interrupts are disabled, no timer interrupts are produced, that's a bad thing. So you cannot do that. In fact, as an ordinary user, you have no privilege to disable the interrupts. It's a kernel mode thing. In user mode, you cannot disable the interrupts. No, you cannot do that. That's first thing. The second thing is, what happens if you have more than one CPU? I mean, if you have 2 CPUs, you disable the interrupt of a CPU, the second CPU still continues, right? It continues. So it can still do this damage. So that's why disabling interrupts is available only to kernel. It's not possible. Okay, it better not be available to the user processes, as you said. What if it crashes? Okay, if I let the ordinary users disable my interrupts, it would be very easy to write harmful code, right? Viruses and etc. That would be a bad thing and doesn't work well on multiprocessors. Okay, again, I said that I don't like it, but if you do this disabling interrupt inside your kernel, then that's a good solution. Okay. But we are not trying to solve this with the kernel. So let's go back. Let's look at this lock variable. Lock variable is this. Okay. I have a global variable named lock. If lock is not zero, then I will be in a loop. This is kind of your solution, right? This is an, see if it's an infinite loop. If lock is not zero, then I will be in a loop. If lock is zero, then I will enter my critical region. Immediately make lock one so that nobody can enter it, and I will do my things and I will leave from the critical region by setting zero to lock. Okay. So, did you read the last line before? Just there was a line that line there. Did you read it? No. Okay. Good, because that was the answer to it. Yeah, okay. Good. So this is the lock variable case. So in this case, remember our process A and process B. I will do this. My global lock is initially is zero. There is a global lock. It is initial value is zero, and I will here printer. What was my the name of my array printer? What is D? What is D? Directory, okay. Printer directory in is file.txt, okay. And then I will increment in by one. And I will make lock zero again. Okay, good. So if I execute this code, this piece of code, if lock is zero, then I will not go into this infinite loop. I will like make lock one. When lock is one, the other process cannot enter this into this critical region. So this is my critical region, right? The other one cannot enter this critical region or its critical region because I locked it. Okay, so this solution is called lock variables, and this part here is your, what was your name? Your name is Kamil. Okay, Kamil's solution, right? Kamil said that let's keep checking if my data is there. I mean, there are some problems with it, but the idea is same. Let's keep checking if the lock is zero or one. If lock is one, then that means that somebody else is in the critical region, right? Okay. So, as we do all the time, there is a problem with this approach. So, what is the problem? Yes.
Checking for the lock and setting the lock are two different operations. There's a time in between them.
Yeah. What happens if I switch from process one to process two at this position? Right? I mean, I checked lock is zero or not. I checked that if the lock is zero, then I entered the critical region. Before I had a chance to make lock one, okay, there's a process switch. And the second process started running. It checked the lock, right? It checked the lock. It says that it is zero. It continued. It made these changes, okay, before leaving the critical region. Again, this process switch happened here. My first process started running again, and it was here, and it made the lock one again. The same problem happened. So, I mean, using the lock idea is good, but it doesn't solve my problem because checking the lock and setting it to one are two different things, and between them a process switch can happen because I didn't disable my interrupts. I didn't disable my interrupts. I don't want to, and I cannot, in fact. So lock variables are good, but as it is, it doesn't work this way. So there is a window between testing for zero and setting it to one. So don't get me wrong. We are going to both use disabling the interrupts and the lock variables, but as it is, it will not be very useful because this doesn't prevent any race conditions. Race conditions will be still there. So how would you do that? I mean, read lock and increment it at the same time. How would you do that? Read lock and increment it at the same time. What?
By using a lock function.
Lock function is from the operating system, right? System call. No, we are not getting any help from the operating system. I mean, if you get help from the operating system, I would use this one. I would ask the operating system to disable the interrupts. I enter my critical region and I get out. What happens if I have multiple processors? I will ask the operating system to lock the memory. I would say that lock the memory bus so that nobody has access to the memory. Right? I could do that. Okay, but I'm not going to do this because I'm not going to get any help from the operating system at first. Okay, so what are we going to do?
Atomic variables.
What's an atomic variable?
When you access that variable or change it, it happens so fast that it can't be...
So fast is not a good solution. So fast still means that...
It cannot be interrupted.
It cannot be interrupted. So you are getting help from the hardware and operating system. I don't want to do that. Without the operating system's help, without the hardware help, I like to achieve this lock variable thing. Some people say that, why don't we do this? Okay. It both checks the lock value and it increments it. You understand the code? It says that if lock is zero, I will increment it, right? But if it is not zero, it will go into the loop and it will say, okay, decrement lock again. So that I can get the effect of it. So this looks like I am both checking my lock and I am incrementing it at the same time. Okay, so what is wrong with it? You understand the code, right? If lock is zero at the beginning, if lock, this is a lock box. If it is zero, then when I come here, I will increment it by one. No, I will first check if it is zero. So that means that, yeah, it is zero. I will leave this loop immediately. When I leave the loop, I know that this value will be one. So I did whatever I wanted. Lock is zero. I can enter my critical region. But when I enter my critical region, lock should be one. So as you see, lock is one. No problem. Let's look at this picture then. If at the beginning lock is one, I came here, I check if lock is zero. Well, it is not zero. So I will go into the loop, but when I go into the loop, I will make lock two, right? Because there is a plus plus operator there. But the body of the loop says that decrement lock by one, so it will be one again. Run the same thing, right? So I will do this until somebody else decrements lock and my value is zero. So does this seem okay? So it looks like this piece of code, it both checks the lock value and increments it at the same time. Well, I mean, if your CPU is smart enough to run C code, yeah, this would be nice. But your CPU runs what? Your CPU runs machine code. Okay, let's look at the assembly of this piece of code. Okay, load the value of lock to R0. Load the value of R0 to R1, register 1. Increment the value of register 1 by 1 and put R1 back to lock. So, and check the value of R0 against 0. So, it looks like my single atomic C code, lock plus plus not equal to 0, is this. So that means that it could be a switch here, 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 right? So there's a possibility of race condition. The single line of C code doesn't mean that it's a single instruction. So it is interruptible. Lock plus plus is not atomic. If you are incrementing a memory variable, you need to load it to the register, increment it, and put it back, right? Three steps. So interrupt can happen anytime. So this idea did not work.
What if you make it volatile and keep it in the registers always?
Again, you need to, how you mean that keep lock in the register all the time?
Yes.
Then how are the other threads are accessing to your register? Register is yours, right? As a thread, it is your register.
Yes.
The other threads, they don't see that register. They see the memory. Lock is a mechanism that we communicate with the other threads. Okay? When I say if the lock is zero, I enter this critical region. If lock is one, I will not enter. Nobody is going to look at your register to enter. They cannot, right? So even if you do that, again, you need to increment it and you need to check. Incrementing and checking will be done at two different instructions, and that will be a bad thing.
Yeah, at least we save time from loading and storing.
You mean you are making it faster inside your... Faster doesn't mean that there is also, no race condition.
Place to interrupt.
There is no difference between 1 in 1,000 race condition possibility and 1 in 1,000,000,000 race condition possibility. It's a race condition. We don't let race conditions happen, okay? I mean, we don't write code that runs 99% of the time. Okay, we write code that runs all the time. Okay, so yes.
We can use another process to log our files or the system because we send a signal to that process. If it says it is open, you can log it. It sends another signal back. If another process tries to send another signal, it will not transfer to that signal.
You are saying that just there should be a server, a lock server, and you ask the lock server to lock some variable for you, and if it is available, then I would do that, right? It could work. It is like a printer spooling, actually. I mean, you tell the printer spooler, print this file for me, and it puts in a queue. And it does that. Yeah, that would be a really actually, that would be a solution. But that means that every time I need to lock some small variable, I need to ask the operating system to do something. Again, you are getting that from the operating system. I mean, you would say that I will ask another process. That means that there is no way to directly connect to that other process. Ask the operating system to do it for you. Again, you are getting the help from the operating system, but if you say that, let's call a function to do this lock for me, okay? But if you do the function, two different threads can call the function at the same time, okay? So, without getting any help from the operating system, let's see how we can do it. I think this is a good example. Okay, good. Critical region is here. I don't care what they do inside the critical region. They are updating something, other things. Anyway, this is called mutual exclusion with busy waiting. Okay, and it's a simple example. It will allow you to have two processes at the same time, but it can be generalized. The idea is this: turn is a global variable. At the beginning, it is zero. There is an infinite loop here, okay? The first process says that if the turn variable is not zero, I will go in an infinite loop, okay? It's not zero. But I know that at the beginning, it is zero, so it will not go into this loop, and it will enter the critical region. After it is done with the critical region, it makes turn one, and it does its non-critical region stuff. And it comes back to the top. What does the second process do? The second process says that if turn is not one, then I will be in an infinite loop. If turn is one, I will enter my critical region. Okay? So it doesn't matter where the switch happens between this one and this one. Let's say this one is running first. Since loop, since turn is zero, it is not one, it will wait in an infinite loop until this line is executed, right? So this will never run until this line is executed. Again, this will never run until this line is executed. That's why they call this strict alternation. Okay? And this is mutual exclusion by busy waiting. So there is a busy wait here. We call it busy waiting. Why? Because it is waiting busily for something to happen. say that I will not leave this loop, exit this loop, quit this loop until turn becomes zero. This one says that I will not do this until turn becomes one. So why didn't we use the same idea? Okay, why don't we use this? Okay, if both of them are running the same code, okay, these are running two different code, right? If both of them are running the same code, that means that both of them can enter the critical region because they're checking for zero. That doesn't work. So they are running different code. This one, when the turn is zero, this one runs. When turn is one, this one runs. Okay, you see any problems with here? I mean, the way I ask you, there should be some problem with this one, right? Okay, that a lock that uses busy waiting is called a spin lock. Something is spinning. I invented some kind of a lock mechanism that uses this infinite loops. By the way, for the locks, this turn should never be registered, right? That was your idea, Edis, right?
Yes.
This turn should never be a register. What would be the problem if I declare this turn as a register variable? Yeah, I would keep this turn in my register, and this one keeps it in its register. Okay, when I make this turn one, the other one would not know that you changed something. Okay, so this turn should be definitely volatile. It should not be kept in a register. Anyway, so do you see any problems with this? It doesn't look like when the switch happens, I will be in a race condition. I mean, because this one makes turn one, then this one makes turn zero. This one waits for this one, and this one waits for this one. Right? And if the turn is one, there is no way this one is going to enter. And if turn is zero, there is no way this one is going to enter the critical region. So what is the problem? Remember our four conditions. What were the conditions? Our mean, yeah. No process may be simultaneously inside their critical region. No, it doesn't happen. Because turn is either one or zero. If it is one of them enters. Zero, yeah, okay. No assumption may be made about the speed or the number of CPUs. I didn't say anything like that. Okay. Okay, number three, no process running outside this critical region may block the other process. Oh, okay, this is the one that I told you about. This doesn't make sense. How could this happen? Okay. In fact, this is the problem that happens with this code. Number three, just read it. No process running outside this critical region may block other process. Let's go back to the strict alternation example again. Number three, say that if somebody is outside the critical region, you cannot block the others from getting into the critical region. It happens here. Well, it doesn't look like, I mean, if turn is zero, it enters the critical region and leaves it. If turn is not one, okay, it enters the critical, is one, it enters the critical region. It doesn't look like, let's look at this then. If turn is zero, I enter the critical region. I made turn one, okay, I did my non-critical region stuff, okay. My non-critical region stuff takes maybe 10 milliseconds. This guy, the non-critical region, maybe it will take this many seconds, right? So this one is busy. This one made, let's say, this one made turn zero, and it entered the critical region, and it will wait for a very, very long time. But that's okay. This one will finish the critical region, non-critical region. We'll go back to the top of the loop. And it will say that if turn is zero, yeah, I will enter my critical region. I will make turn one. I will go into my non-critical region. It will take 10 milliseconds. This one is too busy, still running there. And I will go back to top of the loop. Since turn is not zero, it will not go into the critical region. Why? Because my turn is one. This one did not take the turn yet. It will wait until there's 10 million milliseconds elapses, okay? So this one is waiting at the top of the critical region without entering it. This one is doing some non-critical stuff. Nobody is in the critical region, but nobody can enter the critical region either, right? So the rule number three is violated. Rule number three is violated. So mutual exclusion with strict alternation looks like it works, but it doesn't work actually. They take alternation. This one works and this one works. This is like a switch. This one works and pushes the switch. This one works and pushes the switch the other way. Okay? This one. It's like the light switch, right? When I go out, I push the button, lights go off. When somebody gets in, they push it back, lights are on. So it looks that, but I mean, this one should be free to run. If I don't have the second process, I should be able to go into my critical region anytime I like, right? This one doesn't do that. I mean, let's say I don't have this process. So this code will not work. It will work in the first time, second time it will not work, right? So mutual exclusion with busy waiting using strict alternation. This looks like a good idea, but we violate the condition number three. So process zero is being blocked by a process. Okay, give me an idea to implement this locking mechanism without using any hardware help or the operating system help. Well, strict alternation looks promising, yeah, but this one is nice too. I like this one too, this one. I mean, lock it, but then after that, maybe you should try like double locking it. Lock it, and you know, in some buildings, for example, in our building, you open a door, you go into some kind of a temporary area, you open another door, right? Maybe something like that. Lock something, go into there, and check if somebody else is trying to lock it. And if nobody is doing it, I enter the region.
But it can cause deadlocks.
Yes. It can cause deadlocks?
Yeah.
What do you mean?
For example, we have two locks.
Yeah.
I take the first one.
But you always take the locks in the same sequence. Take the lock one and take lock two.
If some other process or thread is taking the reverse order?
No, they cannot. I mean, this is the rule. Okay. The rule is, first, I mean, when you enter the building, you first enter the first door, right? There is no way that you can use the second door first. You take the first door first, okay? Then the second door. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Last weekend, we see in the system programming when we try to read from the file.
It looks like you are attending this class. Yeah, that's good. Okay.
It's similar to
you said weekend?
Week,
okay.
Yes, and when if it succeeds to return zero, it exits the while loop. Maybe.
Well, it's the same. Isn't that the same? In a critical region, yeah. Well, with your systems programming knowledge, you are not going to solve this problem, because in your systems programming, they don't teach you how to implement these functions. They teach you how to use them, right? They don't teach you how to implement a locking mechanism, right? They teach you mutexes and the semaphores and that kind of stuff. They don't teach you how they are implemented. Okay, I think I am out of my time. You think about it. And next week we will start talking about this. By the way, this is not an easy problem. It took people, very, very smart guys, to solve this problem maybe 10 years. I will show you the code. This is the code. Okay, this is the code. Do you understand? That's the code. It took people maybe 10 years to solve this problem in a simple way like this. They solved it in a complicated way, but simple solution took them 10 years. Hocam